Hi, today we're joined by a very special guest. What was your name again?
We've met.
Hi guys, Lisette here for DNews. By the way, that was Julia, our AP. I totally know her, but it's happened to all of us. We're at the sandwich shop and run into an acquaintance that we met once before at a dinner party, and we know them, but can't remember their name. As embarrassed as you might feel, you should perhaps instead marvel at the fact that you remember them at all, having seen them only once before. Humans are phenomenal at remembering faces. Face processing is super fast, efficient, and incredibly useful. We use it to recognize people, but also to identify their emotional states, communicate with them, and figure out where they're looking. These are all evolutionarily advantageous because they help us determine how to behave towards other people, as well as how to respond to our surroundings. And scientists have found that processing faces specifically works differently than processing other things we see. When we look at something, our eyes take in visual information through the retina and then send it to the occipital cortex. Where it goes from there depends on what you're looking at. With faces, there are multiple areas that seem to be responsible for processing, primarily the inferotemporal cortex, fusiform face area, occipital face area, and the superior temporal sulcus. They're each involved in slightly different functions that together help us process faces. The occipital face area seems to be involved in recognizing parts of faces, like a nose, eyes, or mouth, whereas the fusiform face area seems to configure these parts to help us figure out if it's a face or just some lonely Mr. Potato part left over from your little cousin's play session. We know this because of studies, like this one conducted by neuroscientists from the University of Louvain, Belgium. They used fMRI technology to compare activity of different brain regions as they respond to images of either facial features or full faces, and as one would predict, found that the occipital face area lit up more with individual features than with full faces. Once we know it's a face we're looking at, the superior temporal sulcus seems to help us determine its emotions, whether the person is sad, angry, happy. It also seems to help us read lips to help determine what's being said. Think of being in a loud, crowded bar. Our STS is super helpful with that. One main way researchers have been able to figure this out is by studying people who have suffered brain injury, like stroke, and who have lost their ability to perceive faces, a condition called prosopagnosia. By looking at which areas are damaged, scientists get clues about what those areas are responsible for. But more recently, a team at Stanford was able to specifically induce the loss of facial recognition by stimulating the brain. In their study published in the Journal of Neuroscience, researchers implanted electrodes on a patient's brain. He was suffering from epilepsy, so this was medically necessary for his treatment. It wasn't just a case of, hey, let's cut you open and find out more about face perception, but it did present the opportunity to learn more about it. The researchers found that when they interrupted normal activity by sending low-grade electrical pulses to two specific nerve clusters in the fusiform gyrus, the patient lost his ability to see faces. He explained that the doctor's face warped, he was unrecognizable, and his features seemed to melt. But he could still see everything else clearly. So it's pretty clear that our brains have specialized tools for facial recognition. But this doesn't mean the system is perfect. We're much better at recognizing faces that are familiar versus unfamiliar. Anthony runs down the many reasons why your memory is flawed in this episode here.
So that means that everyone is susceptible to false and changing memory, and that can be problematic when you think about things like therapy or criminal trials that rely on eyewitness accounts. But the Irvine findings could also mean that people with incredibly accurate memories don't have better systems than the rest of us.
So what do you do when you know someone but can't remember their name? Share your thoughts in the comments below and remember to subscribe so you never miss an episode of DNews. Thanks for watching, guys.